God want me to teach you on tonight, praise God, that tomorrow will not look like today. That is my title of my message. Your tomorrow will not look like your today. Someone say, my tomorrow won't look like today. Can you give God praise for what God's getting ready to do in your tomorrow? Praise God. Hallelujah. And so as we were singing the first song, it talked about that your tomorrow is about to be really good. I mean, I hope you're optimistic. I am excited about hearing what God is going to do in spite of man. God is still on the throne. He still controls everything. We cannot forget our God and who we serve. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. So you must not look at past experiences, but look at the future. Others in the room are only focused on what is right in front of their faces. It's all they can live by is what they see. They don't see it, they don't believe it. But I believe there's a group in here that ain't, praise God, just move by what you see. You move by what you believe. Amen. Hallelujah. While some of us in here have our eyes fixed on things above, amen, praise God. Anybody got their eyes focused on things above and not of this world? Amen, we're focused on the power of God. Someone say, I want power from God. Amen, praise God. We're focused on his presence, amen. We're focused on his will, amen. Praise God, we will be fixed, amen, and fulfilled with what God has called us to look at, amen, and that is our life. Give God a shout of praise and say, tomorrow will not look like today. My tomorrow ain't looking like, amen, praise God, today. It's looking better. Someone say better. It's looking better. Go with me to the book of Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6. Very familiar passage of scripture. This is Bible study. So we're going to do some studying, praise God, and make sure we have an understanding, amen, that we're to look for tomorrow. We're supposed to live in tomorrow, because I want you to have an understanding that tomorrow, amen, is a day that God is already in your tomorrow. You're focused on today, going to bed tonight. God is already in you. He already worked out your tomorrow. He working your tomorrow. While you sitting here, God is already working something out for you. Amen. Praise God. While you trying to figure it out, he didn't already worked it out. He's already been tomorrow. He's already been in your next week, and he is already there. Someone say already there. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6, amen. We're going to start off right at verse 25 all the way to 34. And I want you to pay attention, praise God, amen. Don't miss this tonight, because I don't have my sexy specs. Let's do this. Do me a favor real quick, amen, praise God. And I know we're filming, but do it quickly. Could you come and grab your loved one's picture off the altar now? Praise God. I'm in agreement with you that God has gotten, amen, praise God, this answered prayer for your salvation, that there is a prayer of repentance over these souls that's been on this altar. Come on, can you give God praise for that in this house? Amen, praise God, so they'll see salvation, amen, and repentance brought to their homes. That matters, that matters. Look at your neighbor and say, that matters. Amen. They've been here for a week laying on the altar. Amen. So it matters, amen, that your loved one has someone calling on God for them. I've been praying for them daily. Praise God. So now you got prayers in for them. So they cannot act the same. They cannot stay the same. Amen. Praise God. Matthew's chapter 6, when you got it, say amen. Start in verse number 25 and look at what it reads. And it says, therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body what ye shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body than raiment? Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much more better than they? Which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit unto his stature? And why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you, that even Solomon in his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe ye, or you? O ye of what faith? Little faith. Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the who seek? The Gentiles. For your heavenly Father knoweth what ye have need of. These, you have need of all these things. Excuse me. In verse 33 it says, and goes on to say, but seek ye first the what? The kingdom of God and his what? Righteousness, and all these things, clothes, raiment, food, drink, all these things shall be what? Added unto you. Keep going. And he goes on to say, take therefore no thought for the morrow. For the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. So he goes on to tell us that I'm going to, hear me, make it clear, crystal clear to you, amen, that tomorrow there's already junk in your tomorrow. And your way of getting out of the junk, that's the evil thereof, tomorrow is to take no thought about it, because it won't stick to you when you don't worry about it. I pray we see it. I'm gonna start backwards on this, and you gotta follow the message tonight, because understand, some of you are taking too much thought, and you can't add one inch to your stature. You can't grow yourself one inch. Whatever you want, you can't fix it. How many of you ever tried fixing stuff? Amen. You tried, praise God, hear me, work three jobs. I'm gonna make this work. I'm gonna fix this. I remember I was a young minister, and I would sit down from time. I'd tell my wife, I'm gonna go down here and figure this out, because, you know, here we're a little behind right now on things, and I'm gonna go downstairs and figure it out. I would go downstairs in my office. I had a little makeshift office in my basement area, amen, of my company, Audio World. And I would look at the wall and play on the computer to try to figure out how to get more clients, to try to figure it out. I mean, I did it for days. How many of y'all know nothing came out of that? Nothing came out of that, because whenever you start taking up worry and you begin to take up challenges and worry, you miss the resolution of what God wants in your life. In other words, things become bleary, or you're not seeing clearly when you worry. When you take on thoughts, you try to be God, and God will not allow you to have success being him. Is there anybody here got that wisdom? Say, yeah, no, I'm not taking no more thought. I can't, hear me, if you can figure it out, it'll have been worked out already. If you had the answer, you would already have the answer. So taking no thought is understanding that I've gotta let some stuff go and let God handle it. Hallelujah. What do you mean, Pastor? I mean, that means that in life, amen, we're holding life's wheel, but God has the remote control to the car. See, you got to understand the philosophy. Lord, take the wheel. Praise God. Not take the wheel, take the whole car. See, because someone could take a wheel, praise God, and still, amen, not get you where you need to be. God, take the wheel, the gas, accelerator, the brake, amen, take the clutch, amen, take the, hear me, every part about it, take every issue of the car and get me to where I need to go. See, some of us, we don't want to let go of everything in order for God to steer and to get us where we got to go in this year. He's got to take over everything of our life. Lord, take over my finances, take over my mind, take over my body, take over my eating, I need you to take over everything, not just one area. Take the wheel, Lord. No, everything. Amen. Someone say everything. Amen. Praise God. God is our pilot. Amen. Praise God. But we're still on that plane. You got to remember, praise God, when we say, Lord, take control, that means you got to still be on the capsule. You still supposed to be there, amen, while he's controlling it. And there was one video I seen that was just really hilarious, because this young man, praise God, hear me, is in the backseat of the car and Jesus is driving. And hear me, next thing you know, Jesus is driving so erratic, praise God, that he all up in the air and that car going up in there. He said, no, don't worry about it. Jesus goes into the opposite traffic. He said, Jesus, you're going the wrong way. And Jesus said, he turns back and look at him and say, no, I'm not going. I know what I'm doing. Trust me, son. And you see the semi coming straight at him. The next thing you know, the car hits a bump and goes flying airborne. He's in the backseat lifted, going all up on the ceiling and said, help me, Jesus. Then boom, he lands right where he's supposed to be and said, thank you, Jesus, that I'm where I'm supposed to be.
Hear me? But he didn't get him there the way he thought he was going to get there. He took him the way that God wanted him to go. That's why you got to, amen, stay on, hear me, someone say, stay in your seat for the ride. You gotta stick around and see what, amen, the end will be. You don't give up, you don't quit, you don't throw in the towel, you don't say, I'm tired. Hear me, you hold on with everything you got in you until breakthrough comes, because your tomorrow won't look like today if you hold on.
Bible tells us in Psalms 30, weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Amen. Praise God. So look at what it says and pay attention here, because this particular text of scripture in the Bible, it talks about it, amen, five different times. In verse 25, it says, take no thought. In verse 27, it says, taking thought. In verse 28, it says, take ye thought. In verse 31, it says, take no thought. In verse 34, it says, take therefore no thought. He tells us five times in one parable, take no thought. Why would he say something five times? When someone says something to you five times, you need to pay attention. Some of you got to learn to be able to read body language. You keep talking to me, I'm telling you, I'm going to do something to you. And they just said it once. And they said, okay, I'm talking to you in my face. I'm telling you, I'm going to tell you up. Now, you're going to wait till them say it five. By the time that fifth time comes, something about to happen. See, some of you all don't believe things until it happens. They said it five times before that happened. They said it five times before all them lumps came to your life. God tells you things many times before he brings down his hand. And so here he tells us, take no thought. Stop tripping and pay attention, because God is saying, I want you to take no thought. Don't consider, amen, your life seriously. Now there's a term in this world, amen, called YOLO. What does that mean? You only live once. Now they mean it in a negative term. Do whatever you want to do because you only live once. All right, okay, you go rob a bank, you're going to live a few times in that prison cell. You're going to look at life, amen, like you want it to go to end. Praise God. So you don't just do whatever you want to do in this life. Let me say it one more time. I can hear it over there. I only got one amen over here. Praise God. You can't do whatever you want in this life. You must maintain your life. Amen. So I want you to catch this, and I want you now to find this so that way you see this. And so there are some things that have been very difficult in your life, and there's a way around that. Amen. And you got to make certain that you don't miss that. Amen. Praise God. 2 Samuel chapter 12. Let's go there. Let me show you what I mean. Praise God. So that way you have an understanding of how things are supposed to go in life. We have 2 Samuel. Let's go there. 2 Samuel chapter number, praise God, 12. 2 Samuel chapter 12. We're going from verse number 1 all the way down, praise God, we're going to do a lot of reading. All the way on down to verse 12, verse 17 actually. It says, and the Lord said Nathan. Now Nathan was the prophet. That was the prophet of God. That was the prophet that God chose in David's time. This prophet was another concern for David. David had a hearer or a seer to tell him where to go. Most folk don't want to believe that you're supposed to have a seer. When you do not have pastors, do not have a seer that helps your life, you get in trouble. Now, I got this. I can govern my life myself. Okay, you're a spirit being. So if you're not praying and don't have a spiritual covering, what's stopping the enemy from touching every part of your life? What's stopping? Hear me. There's a song saying, somebody pray for me, had me on their mind, took the time to pray for me. I'm so glad they pray. I'm so glad they pray. Took the time to pray for me. Somebody pray. You know the song. Had me on their mind. Took the time to pray. So if you don't have no pastor, no one's taking time to pray for you, you're not praying for you, that means you're a wide target to that drunk driver. You're a wide target to cancer. You're a wide target. You just function as the world functions, and you live up, you go up, and you go down as a vapor. Now, I want you to see this because I want you to acknowledge this because it's roll it up for me, son, real quick. Because some of you don't want to believe. Just take a little piece of it. Yeah, take a little piece of it off of me. Praise God. Let me share this with you. Praise God. I want you to catch this because a lot of people don't understand it. Like that for me, please. And see, and a lot of us want to believe, I'm on fire for God. Everything in my life is going good. But that vapor is what your life is going to produce. And this is you living. I'm 10, I'm 12, I'm good, ain't nothing happening with me. But life is going to do something to you in a while to where life will cease and there'll be no more vapor. This is your life. I'm here. I'm still here. Ain't nothing wrong. I'm still here. I am here right now. Ain't nothing wrong with me. But then a season, look, where your life go? You don't see any more vapor. The Bible says life is as a vapor. You may have 70 years, 50 years, 30 years on here. You're here a moment and can't nobody after a while, can't nobody see you. It might be able to still smell your sin on this earth, but you give another 5-10 minutes, you won't even be able to smell it no more. The Bible is very adamant about that. So Nathan the prophet, he understood this and he comes to David. David, amen, praise God, was living his life, amen, and believing that YOLO was his philosophy. God had blessed David to be king. You already know the story of Goliath and the lion and the bear. You know David. This is David in his glory now. He has 100 wives. He's got a lot of women. Amen. Praise God. And he found himself in a spot where he did something he shouldn't have did. He touched another man's wife. Uriah's wife, Bathsheba. She's bathing up top and he's now watching something he shouldn't have watched and then got involved and got her pregnant and had a baby. And kill Uriah. If you know to read your Bible, you know the story. Uriah, amen, was set up. He put Uriah on the front line of the battle and told his men to back up and leave him out there against the enemy. The enemy surrounded him, killed Uriah. So that was out the gate cold from the king. So that's flat out murder. And he's living now with his wife and the other 100 concubines and wives, amen, praise God. And he believed that now Bathsheba and the new baby that they born in sin is going to now be good. And here comes God, amen, while that child's a baby. And look at what happens in verse number 1. We're in chapter 12, verse number 1. And the Lord sent Nathan unto David, and he came unto him and said unto him, there were two men in one city. The one rich and the other poor. The rich man had exceeding many flocks and herds. Keep going. I need you to move pretty fast on this one. But the poor man had nothing save one little ill lamb, which he had brought and nourished it up. And it grew up together with him and with his children. It did eat of his own meat and drink of his own cup. He was close and laid in his bosom and was unto him as a daughter, this one lamb that he had. And there came a traveler unto the rich man, and he spared, look at this, to take of his own flock, not the rich man's flock, and of his own herd, and to dress for the wayfaring man was he to come unto him. But he took the poor man's lamb, and look at this, and what? And dressed it for the man that was come to him. So he's entreating a guest in his mansion, and he, instead of touching all his flock, all of his lamb, taking one of them to eat, amen, his lamb chops, he goes to the poor man and takes his one lamb. And for the man, hear me, that was what was to come to him. It says, and David's anger was greatly kindled against that man. Look at what he says. And he said unto Nathan, as the Lord liveth, the man that have done this thing shall surely what? There's the proclamation. He spoke what is getting ready to happen to resolve this sin. Pay attention. He spoke what was getting ready to happen to resolve this sin. And David's anger was greatly kindled. He said, surely die. Verse 6, keep going. And he, look at this, shall restore the lamb fourfold because he did this thing and because he had no pity. Keep going, all the way to 12. It says, and Nathan said unto David, thou art the man. Thus said the Lord God of Israel, I anointed thee king over Israel, and I delivered thee out of the hand of Saul. Amen. Keep going. Verse 8, praise God. And I gave thee thy master's house and thy master's wives unto thy bosom, and gave thee the house of Israel and of Judah. And if that had been too little, I would have moreover have given unto thee such as such things. And therefore hast thou despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil in his sight. Thou hast killed Uriah the Hittite with the sword, and hast taken his wife to be thy wife, and hast slain him with the sword of the children of Ammon. Look at this. Now therefore the sword shall never depart from thy house, because thou hast despised me. You despise God. When you do things in private and secret, it despises God. It spits in his face like, I'm going to get away with this. Like, you don't even see it. And God sees everything that we do, and has taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be thy wife. Now, this is Nathan. Nathan, he ain't in the gospel. He ain't running around saying, ooh, you heard about what's happening. Oh, what's up? King David, he hooked up with Bathsheba. And yeah, he killed Uriah. No, so God told him these things. And so truth comes, and all of a sudden, here comes truth about his tomorrow that he don't want to hear, because he had it all secret. He had it all quiet. All right, you can still smell the vapor a little bit, praise God, but just keep letting time go by. That vapor is spreading out, and that's how life does. You'll smell the scent of life, and it's here, and it's gone. And most people think they're going to live forever. That's the most foolish thing, for you to live a life down here on earth and believe you're going to live forever. Ain't nothing that stuff going to happen to me. Yeah, all that happens. Something has to happen. It's appointed for every one of us to be judged in this life. And so this is why we're supposed to live our best life now, as though God's getting ready to do something for us tomorrow. We're supposed to live, amen, saying, God, thank God, I'm going to do something right. Amen, praise God. I don't care who ain't seeing me. I'm going to do what's right, amen, in the sight of God, so therefore my life can be right tomorrow. Watch this. Pay attention. So then he took the wife of Uriah, amen, praise God, and he took this neighbor. He said, it ain't the neighbor, praise God, this parable I'm telling you. You the one did it, David. You're the one guilty. You took Uriah's wife and killed him with the sword of Ammon, amen, praise God, and they now brought judgment on him because of you. So you took a life, so a life must be given out of that. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatever you do, you will reap. So what happens down here, he goes in and says, thus said the Lord, behold, I will raise up evil against thee out of thy own house, and I will take thy wives before thy eyes and give them unto thy neighbors. Look at this. And he shall lie with thy wives in the sight of his son. Keep going. Of this son, rather. It says, for thou did it secretly, but I will do this thing before what? All Israel. And before the son. Keep going. Praise God. And David said unto Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. This is what made David a man after God's own heart. When you find yourself guilty, don't act as though you did not do it. Stop lying to yourself. Amen. When you realize there's something wrong, acknowledge it quickly. Don't sit back and say, look like you didn't do it. And praise God, like you got away with it. Praise God. Acknowledge God and the power of God. Always hug on to truth. Someone say, I love truth. I don't know about you. I love truth. I don't play around. I don't like the feeling of a liar, because it makes me feel as though, amen, praise God, I got to pay for it 10 times over. When you lie, you get away with something, praise God, hear me. You're like, ooh, you lie. You got to pay for that, not just with the cost of the lie, but 10 times over. They're knocking on doors right now, arresting people for the PPP loans. They people in jail now. And they doing 4 or 5 years. So you got to do 4 years, 5 years. Your life jacked up with a prison record now because you took that PPP loan. Lied that you had 7 employees and took $21,000 from the government. Now here come the government. They're knocking on doors, and they hired extra agents. People going to jail right now. They're being indicted. You ain't wasn't a real business. You took that PPP loan. I'll be praying for you. Praise the Lord. Amen. Pastor, I need you to show up for court for me. Give me a letter of my good character. No. That wasn't no good character that you had. What you do with that $21,000? So understand, lying is a bad thing. Now the payment's coming for it. People don't want to pay it. But they shows out at the malls like crazy during COVID. Somerset Mall, High End Mall, where Gucci and Louis stores are, the lines were wrapped around the block at that time. I said, where's all this money coming from? The people standing in the Louis line, I mean, they buying $3,000 bags, $2,000 bags. I mean, hear me. And I'm like, what the world? Now, I work for my, and I ain't got it like that. So tell me what the world are they doing where they walking out there with the big, some say the big bags. The big bags about the size of this podium. You walk out there with the big bags, I mean, you're buying $2,000-$4,000 purses. You're buying big stuff. They took them loans and did that, praise God. And then right after, praise God, about 3-4 months after that, guess what happened at that mall? Everybody was in line, returned them, holding them big old bags in line. I'm like, see that? Taking that stuff back now because they realize they're in trouble. So lying it's not good for your tomorrow. When you learn how to lie and you function in lying, praise God, there's a larger payment for that. Go ahead and tell the truth and go ahead and get it over with. Praise God. That's how I always was. Amen. Praise God. So when I got in trouble, my mother used to know, let me go to Richard. Richard gonna dime out his sister and his brother. Who did it, Richard? She did it. He did it because I ain't getting in trouble for you. Some of y'all took one for the team, praise God. I wasn't going to take one from my brother and team, praise God. If they broke her fish bowl, praise God, him and all the fish on the ground dead, praise God, I ain't going down for that. He did it. And so I have a problem with that. Hey, man, sit back and be like, ooh. See, that's the last time you be throwing that football in the house like that. So you got to learn to love truth. And David knew it. He said, thou art the man. He said, Lord, I have sinned against thee. And against Israel. Look what he says. I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto David, the Lord also hath put away thy sin. Look at this. Thou shalt not die because he repented. If he did not repent, the very thing he said. Now pay attention. Now watch this, because it ain't over. It ain't that easy. Well, we failed. We messed up. We'll just repent. No, watch this, because there's still, for the lie, there's a 10-time penalty that's on your life or around your life when you live in the sight of God through lies. So your tomorrow can't happen if you're lying today. Oh, I'm trying to get you blessed. I'm trying to get you favor. Amen. Praise God. Hear me. You got to now start seeing this. And let me stop playing with my tomorrow by lying today. Let me call it what it is. Let me repent today so therefore I don't have to pay tomorrow. Hear me. Understand, your repenting today is much easier. Amen. And a low cost than having to pay for it tomorrow. So then David now goes in and look what he says, and he goes on to tell him, look, he said, howbeit because by this deed thou hast given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme, the children also, amen, that is born unto thee shall surely die. The child that was born in sin that David and Bathsheba had to die. So he began to now boast and be proudful, saying, no, my baby ain't gonna die. All right, for the sake of reading this story, praise God, going all the way on down, praise God, hear me, we jump over, praise God, amen, we had verse 13, 14. And he said, sin, and look at this, he said, the son shall surely die, and he goes into a place of prayer and goes into fighting for his seed. All right, and fighting, said, my baby ain't gonna die. And as he began to pray and fast, praise God, understand this, God hears his prayers, but the penalty for blood is blood. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. No, Pastor, I ain't got to, you know, if you took money, praise God, hear me, you got to pay for that energy. You got to pay for it. So us as Christians, that's why we're supposed to live righteous, because pay attention to what God said in Matthew 6, amen, praise God, that we seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, then all these things shall be added unto us, because part of the righteousness of God is an added measure of what we give. What we do in earth, we must receive in earth. What we do in heaven, we must receive in heaven. So this is why it's very important to repent. So David goes into a place of consecration, fasting and crying out to the Lord and saying, Lord, please, please don't take my child. Please, please, please. And look at what happened. Jump down to verse number 19. Amen. And his servants began to see the baby had passed, and they didn't come and tell David. He didn't want to believe it. But when David saw that his servants whispered, David perceived that the child was dead. Therefore, David said unto his servants, oh, you changed too fast. Go back. He said unto his servants, is the child dead? And they said, he is what? Dead. God took the life. God took the life because of how the child was born, what David did. So the child could not keep living because of what David did. So that was past. David did in the past, came back on his tomorrow. He didn't think that 9 months later or a year and a half later, that he had to pay this by this child not seeing life, unlifing. Verse number 20, look at what happens. So David goes on, then David arose from the earth and washed and anointed himself and changed his apparel and came into the house of the Lord and did what? And worshiped. He worshiped. Then he came to his own house, and when he required, look at this, they said for bread before him, he did eat. So now he ain't fasting no more. He ain't consecrating no more. He ain't praying no more. He just went to church and started having a good worship time. Hallelujah, Lord, I love you. Lord, you're worthy. Just lost his son. So when you're going through something, praise God, and God judges it, praise God, never charge God foolishly for what you are going through. Praise God. If it's something you did, praise God, hear me. Amen. Praise God. You just take it and say, Lord, I'm never going to do that again. Praise God. You don't go the way that most folk do and charge God foolishly. Why God take my grandmama? Okay, hold on. Don't charge God with that. He ain't responsible for that. What happened? Okay, grandma smoked for 60 years. Praise God. So it's the smoking that did it. It wasn't God. Stop taking the, well, pastor, your plane went down. Okay, hold on. You need to not blame God foolishly. There is an adversary called the devil, amen, that's seeking on this earth whom he may devour. Amen, praise God. And if it happens to your family, you pray that God strengthen you in that time of bereavement and you keep living your life. You don't supposed to go and get in the grave with them. You must remember the good times you had with them and say, I will see you again, if they were saved. That's how it's supposed to be while we walk on this earth. Our tomorrow is very important. So David got up, washed his face, anointed himself, put on some clothes, got to the house of the Lord. He didn't go home and cry. He went to the house of the Lord and began to worship. Lord, you're worthy. You're worthy to be praised. Lord, I know I'll see my child again. Praise God, I'll see my baby again. But Lord, I worship you. I call you faithful. I call you holy. This is why he's a man after God's heart. Number one, he repented. When his sin was called out, he didn't say, oh, that ain't me. I didn't do that. But he got outraged with the story of the rich man taking the one lamb from the poor man. So he judged himself. He said, oh, that man need to be put to death. He got to restore fourfold. He's got to do all these things. He said, Nathan said, well, you the one, David, you the one that owes that debt. And all of a sudden, he realized, like, oh, man. So he repented so he wouldn't have to die. But he moved it on to his child. And I want us to pay attention to this because understand the things we do, it affects our lives through our children. Woo! Praise God. So we've got to now get ourselves lined up so therefore we can be a blessing to our children, that our children ain't got to suffer and go through what we went through, that they can be the head and not the tail, and their tomorrow will be much brighter than our today was. Someone say amen to that. Praise God. So this is why it's so important, praise God, for us to take no thought. So then now there's terminology of this, of taking thought, that you got to make certain you do not miss it. Don't mess up life and miss the opportunity of a lifetime to get what God has for you. There's times right now for everything. You understand there's a time right now, a season for everything. Right now, the enemy is driving people crazy. Hear me, saints. The devil is working through frequencies. I want you to hear this prophet. He's working through frequencies. And he's driving people to the place of quitting and the place of brink of giving up. Do not allow yourself to get weary in this time. God is requiring you, amen, to stir up the gift that's on the inside of you by fasting and by praying and by seeking his face. Hear me, that's why he's calling on these messages to say, get back to the altar, get back to prayer, get back to the place where I can hear me, get you out of your dilemma. You can't figure it out, amen. God can only work it out. So that's why we don't supposed to worry about tomorrow. God is already there. But see, when you try and sit back and worry, praise God, you try and take on all the worries and cares of life, praise God, you're doing that, you're failing, you're getting behind. Because you're all focused on where you should be. There's a place where you should be. And you cannot allow days and weeks to go by where you keep missing where you should be. Where should you be? Look at your neighbor and say, where should you be? Where should you be? You should be in tomorrow. What's your tomorrow look like? You don't even know what tomorrow look like because you're so focused on today and what happened yesterday. You're not looking forward. You're looking backwards. Don't worry about tomorrow because look at this. Focus on today because God's got you. God's got your tomorrow already worked out. So you don't supposed to take thought. But when you start taking thought, you slow down the process of tomorrow. And you want tomorrow to work for you. Something good. Say it. Something good is about to happen to me. Something good. Something good is coming. Come on, those who's watching me, say it. Say, something good is getting ready to come in my life. I'm getting ready to have a good relationship coming to my life. I'm getting ready to have a wonderful holiday. Something good is about to happen that's going to shift my, hear me, it's going to literally change the very trajectory of my future. Amen. Something is about to happen good in my life. Praise God. So I'm excited about it. I ain't sad when I wake up tomorrow morning. I'm excited. Something's about to happen new in my life. Something I ain't have no control over. God's going to bring something in. Something different is about to happen in my life. Other than that, you saying you want something negative to happen in your life. You want a flat tire tomorrow. You want to have accident. No. Something good. You get your mind on focus on good because when you don't focus on anything, you're open to everything. And that's where the craziness is coming from in my mind. People walking away from God and walking away from their husbands, their wives. People just, they're going crazy right now. People are mental right now and have no honor, no respect. They're losing their minds. And so you've got to keep your mind solid. And that's why I love people that are focused in their life and they have understanding that it's my assignment to stay faithful to my family. I will be a provider. I'll get up and go to work tomorrow. I get up and go to work Friday. I get up and go to work next Monday. If they call me on Saturday, I go to work on Saturday. If I come Tuesday, they can count on me for years to come because I'm solid. Not, almond joy. Sometimes they feel like a nut and sometimes they don't. You can't have up and down minds with God. When God comes in and the Holy Spirit comes in, he comes in to change and wash your mind. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. To hear me, to think of yourself almost equal with God. So you're not to be, hear me, down and lowly. You're to be up and above. Someone say amen to that. Praise God. Look at this. Amen. So Psalms tell us, go to Psalms 30. Amen. Praise God. We've been all over, but Psalms 30, let's go there real quick. Psalms 30. Amen. And it talks about the endurance. All right. And God knew this about David. He knew, praise God, that he would mess up. David messed up. And God said, okay, I'm going to fix up what you messed up, David. I'm going to fix it. I'm going to establish my throne with you. I'm still going to work with you because you want to build me a house. You saved, you didn't conquer all these kings. You've been stacking all this silver, this gold to build a temple for me. Hear me, but I ain't going to let you do it. I'm going to let your son do it because your hands are too bloody. Praise God, you've done too much sin. That was the blood of Uriah on his hands, not just the Philistines and the Amorites and everyone else that he killed. Praise God, but hear me, when he killed, it had something else in his heart. Understand this, our hearts is what determines what God does with us. What makes a leader in Christ? A man or a woman's heart? Ain't got no sneakiness in there. See, understand this. Being a pastor now 16 years, praise God, I can't have no sneakiness in my heart. Not in lead people. The devil will tear that up. You destroy everything that I built by the sneakiness of heart. So you can't have these secret side things, this secret this and secret that. I'm going to keep that under low. I'm going to keep this under wrap. No, understand this. You got to be very open and honest. How are you going to have a good relationship? Openness and honesty.
Yeah, I'm angry with you right now. I don't like you right now. Praise God. That's what's needed. But you got to get there. Y'all got to wait some years before you do that. Young folk, don't start that now. Don't do that now. I'm just angry with you. You're going to fight for some hours after that. That comes with maturity to be able to begin to express how you feel. That after years of being married, you start wanting to know how your spouse feels. Now, let me go there for a bit because some of you all don't know this. After some years of marriage, you want to start saying, praise God, you said that word with a little twang on it right there. Are we good? No, we're not good. You embarrassed me in front of that waitress over there. Really? Okay, I didn't mean to. What'd I do? This is how it gets after years. You can hear about yourself, and it can be objective only on you. You're immature when you can't talk about what you do wrong. Oh, there it is. It's all about you. You trying to disrespect me. You don't understand me. Ooh, I just you. And it turns from you to me. And that's what years do to you. Because you learn, praise God, hear me, how to congeal when you be with somebody for a while. You ain't trying to prove your point all the time. That's pride in that marriage that you seen Martin with it. Step, Gina. Well, it's like that, dear. You step. And she said, well, step. Okay. All right. I said, wait, Gina. You know the story. Praise God. He goes hollering to tell her the truth that, no, I really don't mean that. I'm saying that out of anger. And you do a lot of stupid things out of anger. Stay out of anger. Get out of your emotions and out of your thoughts. Amen. That thought be in your mind. You're supposed to bring all those thoughts, every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Hear me? You're supposed to call that into captivity. You're supposed to bind that up. You're supposed to render it inactive in your head. Praise God. And you're supposed to shoo it away. It's like a bird. A thought is like a bird. It may go over your head. Some of you all letting it nest there. It's nested there with baby eggs in there. Thought about it. Don't nobody love me. And you sit there and you meditate on it. Don't nobody love me. Yeah, that time my mama said that. And that time, oh yeah, I remember that. She walked in the room, door went, eh. You sitting there meditating on it. I don't love you. I never did. I didn't want you. And you remember that door, boom, close. You sit there and meditate on that. That thought supposed to be something that you grabbed when you first got saved, supposed to put it down in your spirit and birth it out of you so far to where it comes up and out in the name of Jesus. There's stuff that happened to you, praise God, that you're supposed to be, amen, manifesting and getting out of you in prayer. Hear me, you don't get it out of there just by thinking about it. You get it out in prayer. You go on your knees and begin to start praying. The cracking of that door. And you bring that thought into the obedience of Christ. That you do not have power when I think of it anymore. See, some of you keep stuff having power. You kind of like the way it feels. Okay, and understand, you cannot, amen, like the way it feels. You got to now acknowledge that God is your strength. He is your source. He has the power to get rid of what you got going on. So let's go there. Psalms tells us this, and this is what God is very clear and adamant today about your tomorrow. So God is saying he wants many of you to start thinking of him and believing on him and trusting in him in this. And I'm almost done. I'm almost closing. Look what Psalms 30, amen, praise God, verse 5 and 6 says. It says, for his anger endureth but a moment. His anger, his frustration endureth but for a moment. In his favor is what? That vapor of smoke. You smell smoke still? Because it's how life is. It's here now, and who it stinks? Oh, it stinks. Oh man, life be life, and oh, and then life is over there. And then you look back like, dang, when I was in high school, I really wish I'd have got out there and danced on that dance floor. Now that I'm older, I wouldn't have been shy like that. Oh, I would have had fun in high school if I knew the person I am now. You put me in high school now, it would have been a different experience in high school. But you didn't take that opportunity by the neck and say, I'm going to do it. If people think I'm crazy, so what? But I'm going to live life. Because at the end of the day, praise God, remember this, you're the only one in that flesh, in that earth suit. And you got to be happy with life. Ah, woo! Here's a revelation. Your funeral.
Everybody gonna cry for you. They'll be in deep sorrow. A preacher eulogized the service. That preacher eulogized the service. Praise God. Hear me. He goes out to the funeral site, do the committal. Praise God. Everyone comes back to the house. The food is cooked. Everybody sit around and eat. Music start being played. All right? I want you to see this. Music is being played. You gone. They are talking about you, mentioning memories of how they had this and how we laugh, we joke with one another. Later that night, 8, 9, it's dark. Everybody say, all right, we love you. I'll be praying for you. Be praying with you. Everyone will leave. A week later, praise God, your spouse, your loved ones, your mother, your brother, your sister will be watching TV and they'll see something funny. They'll start laughing. They won't be crying no more. They'll be laughing at Martin or something stupid on TV they just see. They'll see a post on Instagram or something out there that's stupid. Okay, and they'll start laughing again. Hear me, a month from there, they'll be back. Hear me, a week from there, they'll be back to work, working their job as though you never existed. A month later, everything will go back to normal without you. So then when you consider that only you only have maybe a couple weeks in your family's memory, in your spouse memory, in your life ministry. Yeah, they're going to remember you and love you and honor you. But after a while, they're going to get back to their life or what they do. And you won't be remembered until they got to think about you. Oh, yeah, my brother. Oh, yeah, my mother. Oh, yeah, my grandmama. Oh, yeah. Because they're back to their life of doing them. So then the question goes, who you living life to please? Who you trying to make happy? And you're not getting no happiness out of this ride. Who are you really living for then? You living for your baby? I'm living for my babies. I can deny this. I ain't got no fun. I'm just always work, and get up, cook 3 times a day. I got to take care of my mother. Work. You just, everyone else, and then you go and hear me. Everybody else live without you like you wasn't here. So what are you really living for? If your tomorrow is not for you at all. So that's supposed to change the objectivity of not being insensitive, but being us-sensitive, affirmative. Say, I'm living on purpose now. So I'm going to now, hear me, yes, tomorrow I'll go with you and I'll go hang out with you, but wherever we go, if I'm coming to your school recital, then guess what? I'm going to sit there and I'm going to find something in that recital to be excited, that excites me. And I'm going to get up and clap. I'm going to do what I do to make me happy. And I ain't going to care about what nobody think about it. I'm going to start living life for me, because that is where God wants us at, to honor him and live life, not be depressed. And look as though things ain't going to change. Remember, whatever your spirit attracts, that's what comes to you. So if you're attracting, nothing happening. Oh, God, I'm just tired. I've been doing right for a long time. Ain't nothing happening. Okay, well, what you doing about it? What are you doing about it? Praise God. Hear me. What are you doing? So right now, hear me. I'm just telling you some stuff. So I was at one of the local stores this week. Praise God. And they starting to sell slides at Costco and get all these sleds and these little plastic little sleds and everything. I'm like, man, I'm seeing people buying them by the boats, 3 of them, 4 of them, 5 of them at one time. And I'm like, everybody getting them slides because they know snow is coming. Praise God. And they want to be able to get on them hills. So then ever since I see that, everywhere I'm driving, go to the Menards, see a big old hill. I'm like, ooh, that'd be a good hill to hit. And ooh, that'd be a good hill to hit. It's looking at what? Tomorrow. Ain't worried about what about the bills today? What about you get your grass cut today? All that stuff that's in your today don't matter. You start living, hear me, in this day. Every day you live like there's no tomorrow. You start getting the best out of life. And you start saying, no, I'm not going to settle for what life has for me. I'm going to get some joy out of this thing called life. I'm going to live, amen, my life. I like living this kind of life, amen? It's the best life, amen? Praise God. So this is what he says. He says, his anger kindles for a moment, and in his favor is life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the what? Joy comes when? Tomorrow morning. Joy is waiting on you. So you don't supposed to go to bed mad tonight. If joy waiting on you tomorrow morning, why are you going to bed mad? That boss tripped today on me. Joy coming in the morning. So the boss may have a happy day. He coming in. So then you supposed to be psychotic like he is. mad with him today, then go in there tomorrow. He's smiling, cracking jokes. Hey, hey, how's it going? How's it going there? The son, you doing good today? All right. What I need you to do is this. And like, all right, you know, I had my coffee. I'm good today. And you're supposed to now be happy. But yesterday, he went off on you. So you're supposed to have been depressed yesterday and then happy with him today. When people are up and down, you don't supposed to be up and down. Amen. Praise God. So that's why I've learned to hear me, accept my life. I'm not going to let you, Debbie, down or take me down. This is the day the Lord has made. I'm going to rejoice and be glad in it, because when I woke up this morning, I was able to lift my legs up. Praise God. I was able to lift my arms up. My eyes work. Praise God. I can breathe on my own. Thank God. Hallelujah. I'm thankful for what God brought in this day. I woke up to joy this morning, and you ain't got to give me no joy. I got mine. So stop waiting on folk to give you joy. Praise God. Y'all heard Anita Baker. She said, you bring me joy. Praise God. Hear me. Stop waiting on folk to bring you joy. Amen. You bring some joy. Can you be the joy bringer? Can you be the one saying, good morning, everybody? What up? What up? What up? Like, man, what you? You on some dope or something? No. I'm on hope. I'm on the Holy Spirit. I ain't on dope. I'm on hope. Amen. I'm hopeful. I know what God is getting ready to do. God is ready to do something for me. So I'm going to give him a shout in advance. Woo! Praise God. Hear me. And look at what verse 6 has to say about that. And so it says, and in my prosperity, I said, I shall never be what? Moved. This is David talking. This is David, the same man that lost that baby. This is David, the man after God's own heart. He said, weeping man endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. He said, in my prosperity, I said in your prosperity, you say to yourself, I shall never be moved. That means that you ain't gonna never go down to lack again in your prosperity. That's in your soul, in your spirit, in your finances, in your mind. Stop letting your mind go down to poverty. Hear me, stop taking those poverty thoughts that, oh yeah, well, you know, ain't nothing gonna get better. Oh, this is what it is. No, stop that. Amen. Praise God, you're not what you are. You're going to get older. You're going to get wiser. You're going to get mature. Amen. Praise God. So everything changes. Just look for what you're going through to change and be happy about it. There's something good is about to happen in our lives. Amen. Praise God. And that is where God wants us at. And we want to live like that and understand that life is short. We're through. I want you to see this. So that way you don't miss it anymore. You don't have yourself looking for a falsehood in tomorrow, but you're able to like lean on tomorrow and begin to do stuff that affects your tomorrow. See, I'm optimistic about my life, about business, about my family. I'm optimistic. I mean, I'm already looking at it now. My family has grown. So I need some more chairs around the table. I'm like, okay, now how this work? Now Isaiah get a girl, and praise God, when they start bringing babies, that little dinette said, I got it. Okay, praise God, we here. We can't slide no more chairs up to the table. I mean, I put both leaves in it. That table stretches as wide as it can be stretched. I mean, okay, Lord Jesus, we need more room in the house. All the children sit at the kitchenette set, then we sit at the dining room set, and I still need more room. So that's my tomorrow. So I'm looking now and saying, what am I going to do about that tomorrow? What's new there? What's different there? Okay, where's my projected growth at? I'm looking forward to seeing now the pictures that were on this altar. Amen. Your children, your brothers, your sisters, your uncles, your auntie, they repent and they come in here. Praise God. Now I got to prepare for catechism again. I got to make sure I get that class right. I got to make certain baptism is right. So when people want to go down in the water, amen, I'm charged up and my leaders are charged up and excited about, amen, giving people the Holy Spirit. That is where my mind is on tomorrow, not on where we was at yesterday.